So in today's session, on applied mathematical finance, I like to start with, say, a big interest rate models. I call this section here discrete forward rate term structure models. That's just a different name for a famous model, the model that was formerly known as LIBOR market model. Well, but I've chosen this name because the word LIBOR is maybe only there for historic reason. Yeah, it is the London Interbank Offer Rate, and it was a methodology to, say, quote an interest rate, and that interest rate was just by chance exactly of the form as we had defined it, namely our simple rate, our forward rate. So the guy which was defined here in definition 111, So this interest rate, that was more or less the performance of the bond portfolio, the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end divided by the bond zero coupon bond at the end relative to the period length, so divided by the period length. So that was our definition for the interest rates. And yeah, we defined several interest rates here in our section on our session on interest rates. So there was this definition for the forward rates. All rates were derived from zero coupon bond prices in some way. There was also the definition of the instantaneous forward rate, which was just that object. Yeah, the forward rate for an infinitesimal small period. So it was then a continuum of such forward rates, where here, if you have a discretization into certain time points, TI, TI plus one, TI plus two, then you have just a finite number of interest rates. And there was also the short rate, which was the instantaneous forward rate just for the period, the infinitesimal period at the current time. And I already mentioned in this session here on interest rates that these objects then are the basic object for models to model the interest rate curve as stochastic process. And when we model here the forward rate L, so the discrete forward rate, we arrive at the model which I will introduce today. If you model the instantaneous forward rate, if you write down a stochastic process for the instantaneous forward rate, that is called the Heath-Jerome-Morton framework. And if you write down a model for the short rate, so just for this single rate, which constitutes the instantaneous forward rate for the current period, then you have the class or the family of short rate models. So these models you see here are actually just different in terms of what is the object for which you write down the stochastic differential equation. And since all these interest rates are linked to each other, because they're all going back to zero coupon bond prices, there's also a link between all these models. And actually here, this model for the discrete forward rate or the LIBOR market model, formerly known as LIBOR market model, it is just the Heath-Jerome-Morton framework with a very special structure. And also the LIBOR market model or the discretized forward rate model is just a short rate model. You can reformulate many of these models very easily into the other form. But it is that certain nice properties are not preserved. For example, I can rewrite this model for the forward rate as a Markov process, So our stochastic process, where the increment only depends on the current observed value, yeah, and not on the full past. But if I rewrite it as a short rate model, it's no longer Markovian. Yeah? So it has some kind of memory, yeah, and needs the whole evolution. So it is Markovian in a high state space. So there are certain mathematical properties that are valid in one coordinate frame and not in the other ones. But apart from this, they are very much the same. And if you start reading books now about term structure models, so the stuff that I like to do today, yeah, modeling the whole interest rate curve, then often these books or lectures start by looking at short rate models. And really, I don't like this because I believe it is well, the short rates model, they are special in a certain sense. They make some strong assumption. They write down the model directly under the equivalent martingale measure and do not make the transformation from real measure to equivalent martingale measure. And and if you don't see this from the beginning, yeah, so maybe this is a little bit disturbing. And for that reason, I start introducing term structure models by modeling the forward rate. Yeah? So today we will start modeling the forward rate. We have already seen models for the forward rate. Recall that we had the section where we were valuing an option on the forward rate, the Black model. So we were writing down a stochastic differential equation for a single forward rate. And then we derived an analytic formula, a Black-Scholes-like formula, for an option on this rate. So what's the difference? So the difference is that in today's session, I like to write down a system of stochastic differential equations, which models the whole interest rate curve. So maybe not the whole interest rate curve, but a discretized version of the interest rate curve. So I consider now interest rates here for different periods, say from T0 to T1, from T1 to T2, from T2 to T3. Okay, so I consider now an interest rate curve a family of forward rates, and all those forward rates here are allowed to move up or down. Yeah? So it will be a curve of many interest rates. And there is a certain constraint between these interest rates we will derive. And once we have this, we can actually value almost all derivatives on interest rates. So here in this section on the Black model, there was just the option on this single rate, yeah. So consider the case where you like to value the difference of an option on the difference of two forward rates, yeah. So like that, okay, and zero. So then you need a model for both quantities, and maybe this model is not so so easy, yeah, to find an analytic formula for this. Yeah, so that was a small introduction, yeah, so small motivation why I actually like to start with writing down now a model, yeah, for the whole interest rate curve by looking at the simple forward rate, the simple rate. So we will write down the model specification, and then we will derive the drift. So that's, remember, very similar to what we did for the Black model. So for the Black model, for to value a caplet, we wrote down the model under the real probability measure P. And then we had a certain financial product we liked to value. So what did we do? So we recalled that we had this nice little theorem, the universal pricing theorem, that told us if we choose a certain numerator and if we move then to the corresponding equivalent martingale measure, then we can value derivatives by just taking the expectation of the future values. So, and moving to this different measure, so changing the measure can be reinterpreted as changing the values. So that was Gesanov theorem. Yeah? So changing the measure is equivalent to changing the values under certain assumption. So and the change of values is just a drift term. So under the different measure, the process will look different. It has a drift. And the trick now to get into the situation that we can apply this theorem is that we don't search for the measure, we search for how does the process look like under the new measure. So that was also what we did here back for the Black model. So we've chosen a numerator. And then we wanted to know how does the process look under this new measure corresponding to this numerator, and what is the measure? The measure is the equivalent martingale measure such that all assets divided by the numerator are martingales. And this is the information that you need in order to find how the process look like. Yeah, so you have certain stochastic processes that are martingales. And here in this session on the caplet, there was a very nice special situation that already L was a martingale under this measure. So now going back to what we like to do today, you immediately see that the issue is that we now choose one numerator. And maybe the numerator is such that one of those guys here, for example, that one, is a martingale. But for sure, not all of these guys will be martingales. So recall the convexity adjustment. We had a session on the convexity adjustment. If you choose the numerator that corresponds to the zero Cooper bond, which pays in Tn, yeah, this here is now Tn. If you choose this numerator, then you have that this forward rate here is a martingale, but a forward rate that pays at a different point in time, so is associated with a different period, is not a martingale. It will get this convexity adjustment. Yeah. So changing the time introduce this convexity adjustment. So for this period here, we cannot expect that the drift is zero and it's not a martingale. So the big step we are doing now is to ask ourselves, we have many stochastic processes for interest rates under a common measure. Yeah? So there's one numerator and one equivalent martingale measure, and there is a full system of stochastic differential equations for these interest rates. Yeah, so let's start. So the model specification, of course, starts by a choice of the tenor structure. So we have a time discretization. And this time discretization is, as I have drawn it already, the discretization of the interest rate curve. So you have periods T0, T1. Okay, so maybe have T0 really the starting point. So let's have T0 here. T2. T3 and so on. And this is a time discretization that discretizes our interest rate curve. So you can make it finer, yeah. Then we need more computer memory to store the objects of our model, but the model will be maybe more accurate. Maybe your financial product only requires 3 months interest rates every 3 months, yeah. Then it's maybe sufficient to only model these. Alternatively, if you have a model that models only a finite number of interest rates, you can maybe later introduce some kind of interpolation. Yeah. So later in this lecture, we will have the question, okay, can we actually refine this interest rate into smaller periods by just knowing this model? But at the moment, I only like to model these interest rates. So it's a family of interest rates. The interest rates which we model are the simple rates, the simple forward rates, LI. So from TI to TI plus one, we will model N forward rates. So the last one goes from TN minus one to TN. So here I runs from zero to N minus one. I will often also write down the stochastic differential equation for L0, but actually L0 is already fixed. Yeah? So you remember that these were the rates that fix at the beginning of the period. The natural payment date is the end of the period. So, but these rates here, they have still stochasticity. Yeah? So they will move until time little t reaches the fixing date of the rate. So at a certain point in time, the evolution of this rate will stop. Yeah? And other rates will continue. But from a mathematical point of view, this is not a big problem. Yeah, you can just set the sigma parameter, the volatility, to zero, and then the rate stops. Okay, so this is the discretization of our interest rate curve. We have several periods. The number N can be large. Yeah? So if you have, for example, 20 years, yeah, and you have semi-annual rates every 6 months, yeah, you already have 40 interest rates. Yeah? If you have every 3 months, it's 80 interest rates. So it can be a large number. So this will be a high-dimensional state space. Yeah? So we have here maybe 80, 120 or what interest rates. So it's a stochastic process, which we will now specify in maybe 100 dimensions, yeah, in 40, 80, whatever dimensions. Here's the stochastic process. So we model the rates Li as E2 processes. So the forward rates Li are given as E2 stochastic processes. So DLi has a certain drift. And then comes a parameter sigma I of t and Li of t times the increment of the Brownian motion dwi. And this is now written down under the measure p. So what are the model parameters or the ingredients here of our model? So the model parameters are, of course, the initial value. So how should that be chosen? Yeah, so that's maybe the interest rate curve we observe initially, we observe today. Then the model parameter is the function sigma. Yeah? So the volatility of the interest rates. And now you remember these were the parameters we also had for the Black model, for the Kaplet. Yeah, it was the initial value and the sigma I. Mu was not a model parameter. because we moved to the equivalent martingale measure, and from that we could deduce how the drift looks under the equivalent martingale measure. So mu was actually prescribed by the fact that we like to perform risk-neutral valuation of derivatives. So that was not a free parameter. Here in this model, we have another free parameter. And this is, since we now have a system of equations, so I have here that I model n interest rates, yeah, L0, L1, Ln minus 1. Okay, L0 is already fixed, yeah, if you start in T0, but you model many interest rates. So then you can ask yourself, okay, if they have all independent Brownian drivers, yeah, so everyone has another Brownian motion, what is the relation between the Brownian drivers? I mean, are they independent or are they not independent? So we can prescribe some link between these stochastic processes. And okay, what should this link be? So recall now that I'm modeling here an interest rate curve. So there's one interest rate here, and there's another interest rate here. So, and maybe another one is here, and another one is here. Yeah? So it's a whole curve. And maybe it should be that interest rates which are near to each other, yeah, they move maybe in a more correlated way. Yeah? So maybe everything moves up and down here compared to an interest rate that is further away. Yeah, so that is maybe a little bit more independent. So there should be some kind of correlation structure. So I can model this correlation structure by prescribing the correlation between the Brownian motions. So, and we have another model parameter here, oops, which is the correlation between the Brownian motions. So that's another ingredient of, oops, of the model. It is, what is the relation between the Brownian motions? Okay, so maybe I draw it like that. Okay, so you see that at this point, the model is becoming richer than what we did for the Kaplet. For the Kaplet, we just looked at a single forward rate. So there was no need to model the correlation to the other forward rates. But maybe you also recall when we did the quantum Kaplet, we modeled two quantities. It was the forward rate, the forward rate, and the forward currency exchange rate, the FFX. And there we introduced another parameter. It was the correlation between the forward rate and the forward exchange rate, currency exchange rate. Yeah. So that was already a step in this direction, that we had two stochastic processes and we also modeled the instantaneous correlation. So we have these model parameters here, the initial value, the coefficient in front of the DW of a rate, and the correlation. Yeah, what else do we have in this model? Yeah, maybe you see here that I have specified that the initial value can be anything but should be larger than minus 1 divided by delta t. Okay, that's maybe a bit strange. So why I have this? So yeah, when I prepared this slide, I thought maybe I could write the initial values just from R. Yeah? Could be any value. But you have to be a little bit careful. Yeah? Recall, what is the forward rate? The forward rate Li. So this is the forward rate from the period Ti to Ti plus 1. Okay, so what is it? It is 1 divided by the period length, so that is delta Ti, the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. So Pti minus Pti plus 1 divided by Pti plus 1. Okay, so that's actually the ratio of Pti divided by Pti plus 1 minus 1. Oops. So okay, and so now I like to have that the zero coupon bond price is larger than zero. Okay, so a zero coupon bond price should not be negative. So why? So if the zero coupon bond price is negative, so if either PTI or PTI plus 1 is negative, yeah, then the model is not free of arbitrage. Because then I can buy a product, the zero coupon bond, which has a negative value. So it means I get something paid, which has a guaranteed future payment. So if I assume that zero coupon bond prices are positive, then this implies that this here is larger than minus 1 divided by delta Ti. Okay, so you see that in case that you make the very natural assumption that all zero coupon bond prices are positive, then this implies that the forward rate has a lower bound. So the lower bound is not zero, yeah? Negative interest rates are possible, and the lower bound is also very large. And in fact, if you make the period length very small, it becomes very, very large, yeah? So in very small periods, interest rates can become very largely negative, huh? So very small. But in this discretized setup, there is some lower bound in case you like to have this absence of arbitrage in the sense that a zero coupon bond is not negative. Yeah, so you can maybe forget about this lower bound, yeah, and in many specification you don't see it. So I just wanted to mention it here. It's maybe just a small remark that there could be this constraint. So I'm writing the model here in quite natural form. So I'm writing it here with sigma is a function of time, but also a function of Li. And maybe even Li is not general enough. You can have it as a function of all the Ls. Yeah? So maybe you can drop here the I. So let's remove here the I and consider it as a function of the full vector. Yeah? That would be perfectly okay. Yeah? It's a very general description of the model. Well, the original version of this model was not in this general form, but I will work with this general form when I derive the drift, yeah, because it is as easy as with the original version of the model, and we can later also derive the drift then for other versions of the model. The original form of this model was just the log normal model that we also used for the Kaplet. Yeah? So in its original form, So the original version of the LIBOR market model, yeah, so that was the original version of the LIBOR market model. There was the assumption that it was a log normal model. So if the initial value is positive, yeah, the forward rate stays positive. Yeah, so if the initial value is non-negative, the forward rate stays is non-negative. So it was a log normal model. So log normal here means that the coefficient in front of the Brownian motion is just a multiple of Li. Yeah? So it's Li sigma I dwi. And because I don't want to use the same letter sigma I use now sigma I superscript L. Yeah? It's just a label saying that this is the sigma, the coefficient for the log normal model. And you see that the log normal model is just a special version of our more general model. It's sigma I, the function of our general model, is L times sigma I L. Okay, so you see that in this specification, in this general version here, I allow that the volatility coefficient is actually a random variable. It's a function of a random variable. It's a function of Li. So it's already a model with stochastic volatility. But it's a special case of a model with a stochastic volatility called a local volatility model, where this coefficient is just given as a function of the object which we are modeling. Yeah? It's a function of the object which we are modeling. So there's no independent or additional stochastic process driving the parameter sigma. The parameter sigma is given as a function of the object which we are modeling. So it's a local volatility model. And you see that this log normal version, so the log normal version, which we also used in the session on valuation of the caplet. So here now, number 109 is, 109 is the same stochastic process that we used to value the caplet. It's the Plaque model. And the only difference to the section when we looked at the Plaque model is that we have now here n independent Plaque models. Well, maybe independent up to the fact that we specify a correlation between these guys, by specifying here our correlation model. So you see that this term structure model, or the classical LIBOR market model, is not something very sophisticated. It's just n individual Plaque models under a common measure with some additional correlation matrix. Okay. Of course, when we had this session here on the interest rates models where we derived the analytic formulas, yeah, there was the Plaque model for the caplet, but we also looked at the Bachelier model. So that was then assuming a normal dynamic, and we can have the same here. So here, plugging in sigma I multiplied with Li gives us the Plaque model. If I just plug in a single function sigma I, then I have the Bachelier model. So while that one here is now my term structure model with a log normal dynamic, that one here is my term structure model with a normal dynamic. So now I can also write this model with a normal dynamic, and normal dynamic refers to having here just a single coefficient sigma I, which just depends on time, sigma being a deterministic function, then this creates me the normal dynamic. Yeah? So the integral of sigma I dwi, yeah, is a normal distributed random variable with variance integral sigma I squared. Okay, so that were now the general formulation, then two different versions of the model. And I have a third version, which is also very popular in industry. It is somewhat a mixture of the two. No? So, you know, the log normal version has the property, if the initial value is positive, then the interest rates will stay positive. But, you know, negative interest rates are possible, yeah? And they are not some artifact. Yeah, they are reasonable. Yeah? So interest rates can become negative. So this model does not allow negative interest rates if the initial value is I was disturbed. Was there there's a question. Should there be an L in the drift term? Good point. I will comment on this. Yeah, so maybe just let me just answer it now. In the slide on the Black model, I had an L here. Here I don't have it. Yeah, I just leave mu p can be anything, and actually it's also maybe not so 100% correct to have an L there. In a log normal model, there will be an L if you go to the equivalent martingale measure. But here I like to have the drift more general. It will of course turn out. Yeah, so you can prove that. If you move to the equivalent martingale measure and there is an L in front of the sigma, there's also an L in front of the mu. But I believe you have to prove this. Yeah? You shouldn't assume it. And that's the reason why I don't have this on the slide. Yeah? So very good question. Should there be an L in front of the mu? I didn't have it here on purpose. Okay. So, where was I? So now I have the general form of the model, which is here. I have two different versions, the log normal one and the normal one. And we know that the log normal one has the property that if initial value is positive, or the interest rates will stay positive. But we know that negative rates are possible. So maybe you think that you should switch to the normal one because it is a model which also allows negative interest rates. And another version of the model, yeah, is just a mixture of the two. So it's the displaced model, which can be considered as a mixture of the log normal and the normal model. So the coefficient in front of the delta W is L plus some constant multiplied with sigma delta W. So this is a little bit like an interpolation of the log normal and the normal one. Okay, why is this a little bit like an interpolation of the log normal one? So here the displaced model, yeah, is characterized by this. So of course you can rewrite this here like Li of t times sigma I plus di times sigma I Okay. DW. Okay. And now you can make sigma I very small and DI very large, yeah, which will make the model look like a normal model. Or you can make DI very small and sigma I set it to sigma IL, and it will make the model a log normal model. Okay, so you see that this is a little bit like an interpolation between the two models. Yeah, this is the displaced model. And well, since small remark, yeah, since if you differentiate a constant, yeah, DLI, it's zero. So DDI, sorry, did I say LI? I wanted to say, so DI is just a constant. So if you differentiate a constant, so if you apply D to DI, that's just zero. So this is just the same as DLI. So you see that this is just our model plus LI plus DI sigma I DWI. So you see that this model is actually specifying that the displaced quantity, let's call this here maybe XI. Yeah. So XI, so this is the displaced or the shifted forward rate. The displaced LI. So this one is log normal. Yeah. So what you actually do here is that you maybe have a log normal model. So a log normal distribution looks like this. Okay, so this here is log normal. And then it's not L that is log normal, it's L plus D that is log normal. So that means that L is shifted. So the point zero is actually the point minus D or minus DI. So then the log normal distribution looks like this. So in this model, if DI is positive, in this model, negative interest rates are possible up to a lower bound of minus D. Okay, so for that reason here, the initial value should be above minus D. So I'm shifting the whole distribution to the left if I use a positive DI. So this is the displaced log normal model, also very, very, very popular in industry. And you see that this is just another version of our model where the coefficient function, our local volatility function, is Li plus Di times sigma i deterministic function. So now we have specified our model, and you maybe already see this is a little bit more than just a model. It's a full model framework. Yeah, it's a model framework because we are still free to specify here this coefficient sigma I, and we are also free to specify this coefficient rho I with the correlation. So later when I implement this in the computer, I will actually implement a full model framework where we can plug in different volatility functions, different parameters sigma I, and we can plug in different correlation structures, and we can explore how the model looks like. And the funny thing is that apart from this fact that we have a discretization here, many models, like for example the short rate model, the Hull-White model, the Ho-Lee model, many popular models are just special choices of this volatility structure. So you can actually create a short rate model within this framework. So this framework is really a big useful thing, and we tried to do a nice object-oriented implementation of it. Already for the implementation part, you maybe see that this here should be maybe specified by an interface so that you can plug in different volatility structures and create many different models out of your model framework. So the coefficients which appeared on the slides, yeah. So for this special version of the log normal model, so the sigma I superscript L, or for the normal version or for the displaced version, these are deterministic functions. The drift is a stochastic process. We will derive the drift in the next subsection. And the correlation of the Brownian motion, so the rho ijs, is also a deterministic function. Yeah, so that these are plugged in into this model frameworks, and we will later choose them. Of course, you can generalize this model by using stochastic processes in place of these functions. Everything I do today will still be valid if you use the more general processes. Concluding remark on the model specification, equation 109, though that was our first special form, is a log normal model for the forward rate. And it is just Plek's model. So the one which we used when we looked at the caplet, yeah. So it is just Plek's model, but now for all forward rates simultaneously. Yeah. So equation 109 is identical to what we did for the caplet. And for the caplet, there was a specific choice of numerator and a specific measure that made this specific forward rate a martingale. And the difficulty we have here is that we have to choose one numerator, one probability measure, and then maybe one forward rate is drift free, but maybe not the others. So, but apart from this, yeah, this model is not a real novelty. Yeah, it's just n Plek models under a unified probability measure. And likewise, the number 110 is equivalent to considering n Bachelier models under a unified probability measure. So that's what we have here. So when we were looking at the Plek model to evaluate caplet, so when we looked at the Plek model to evaluate a caplet, actually, the value of this option, the caplet, didn't depend on how the function sigma was varying over time. So if you look at the Plek formula back, you see the only ingredients is the integral of sigma I squared. Yeah? So it is just the variance you have accumulated, yeah, from time zero to time maturity. So here the model is general. Yeah, it has a time-dependent parameter sigma. Actually, I also assumed already in this section on the caplet that the parameter is time-dependent. Yeah? So that was maybe just for didactical reasons that I made this assumption. But here it's now really a generalization of the model. We will see this later when we calibrate the model to swaptions, yeah, that it's helpful to have a time-dependent parameter. And then another degree of freedom we have here in addition is that we have a correlation structure for driving the Brownian motions. And as I mentioned, yeah, there are further generalizations when you consider the model to have a parameter sigma that is driven by an independent stochastic driver, yeah, or there is another stochastic driver involved, yeah, could have a correlation driving the parameter sigma. So here sigma is allowed to be a local volatility, and it can easily generalize to be another stochastic process. So in that sense, this original form of the model, so the model in this log normal version is maybe just seen as the starting point of a whole family of models. Yeah, it's a special version, yeah, and there are many generalizations you will find also in the literature. And this starting point is maybe there for historical reason, because the Black model, yeah, because it is just for a Kaplet, a Black-Scholes model, is well understood. So this is maybe just a starting point for a whole family, yeah, of models. Before I start deriving the drift, another remark on our time discretization. Yeah? So we model a time discrete tenor structure from T0 to Tn. So there's T1, T2, and so on here. So what does this mean? So actually, it means that I only model a finite set of these forward rates. So it means that I only have the interest rate curve at very specific dates. So you know that from this discrete set of forward rates, you can reconstruct the zero coupon bond prices of all the zero coupon bonds that have maturity at these dates. Okay. So in addition, I can also reconstruct the interest rate for a larger period. So maybe from here to here. Maybe I choose a different color. So maybe from here to here. So I can have the interest rate from T4 to T7, because I know there is the forward rate from T4 to T7 is the ratio of the zero coupon bond T4 divided by the zero coupon bond T7 minus 1 divided by the period length. Yeah? And I can reconstruct all zero coupon bonds. So our equation system, so our system of stochastic differential equations, so that was in the general form 108, yeah, determines the evolution of all zero coupon bond prices that have maturity on this time discretization. And thus, it also determines all interest rates for all kind of periods that are within this time discretization. So what I do not have yet is, for example, an interest rate for a smaller period from here to here. I don't have that. Or an interest rate for a period that goes across this, yeah. So whenever starting point or end point are not in this time discretization, I do not have information about this interest rate. So the model has many gaps, yeah, large gaps, yeah. But we can later fill these gaps by an interpolation. We have to make the interpolation somewhat consistent with the model. And sometimes people in practice don't care about this and perform some kind of interpolation which is not consistent with the model. If you need an exact model for an interest rate that is finer, you have to refine the discretization and write down the model for the finer discretization. So this is the current situation. So it's not describing the full interest rate curve, with all periods. It's just describing a subset, but often this subset is enough to value almost all financial derivatives on interest rates. So now let's derive the drift. Okay, so why am I deriving the drift? So the reason that I like to derive now the drift is I like to find the specification of the model under the equivalent martingale measure. So why? Because I like to use the model to value derivatives by applying our universal pricing theorem. Okay, so I know that the universal pricing theorem requires that I can move here to an equivalent martingale measure. So I assume all the assumptions to do this are fulfilled. So then we choose a numerator, and we know that if the equivalent martingale measure exists, then all traded assets divided by the numerators are martingales. So it means that they have drift zero. And maybe this allows now to find how does the stochastic process of L look under this measure. Because I'm too lazy to derive how the measure looks, I just like to derive how the process looks. From the knowledge that certain processes, namely traded assets divided by the numerators, are martingales. So that's the general scheme, yeah, and it's often the same. So the derivation of the drift. So as we did for the caplet or for the quanto caplet, our first step is to choose a numerator and derive the drift under the equivalent martingale measure. So this deriving the drift under the equivalent martingale measure is just like finding the measure, yeah. But instead of finding the measure, it's assume the measure is already there. So assume that the Brownian motion is already under this measure. How does the drift look like? Yeah? It's a little bit like Gesanov the other way around. Yeah, you don't know that you go from one measure to the other. You know that you already are under the target measure. And now you ask, what should the drift be under this measure? You know that Gesanov has modified the drift. So it is that under this measure, I have a modified drift here. Everything else is the same. So I still have here the coefficient sigma I in front of the dw. So now I ask myself, if we move to the measure qn associated with the numerator n, what does this drift look like? And for the caplet, the quanto caplet, and also in other situations, there was a special choice of numerator that was very suitable for our application. So the application was here value the financial product. So, for example, for the caplet, it was the numerator associated with the payment date, because then the numerator vanished in this expectation. Now here, the situation is different. I like to develop this model as a general model that I can use in a Monte Carlo simulation for many different financial products. So I would like to build now a very general model, not specific to a single financial product. So for that reason, I just choose now out of the blue certain numerators, and we will derive the drift. There will be the numerator that is associated with a certain Zurich-Cobourg bond. There will be the numerator that is associated with the rolling reinvestment strategy. And what is very nice, if we later look at the implementation and then look at a little bit some numerical experiments, while these numerators, while it maybe doesn't matter anymore that this numerator is a specific choice for a certain financial product, we will see that these numerators have different numerical approximation properties. So there are certain numerators that have smaller numerical errors than others. And that's really now funny aspect of the choice of Numerair. So let's start deriving the drift for one Numerair. Let's choose the zero coupon bond that pays one at a certain time. Okay, so which zero coupon bond do we choose? So if this here is our tenor discretization from T0 to Tn, yeah, so this is T1, T2, and so on. Okay, Tn minus one here. So if I would now choose, for example, the zero coupon bond that would be one here at this point, then well, my Numerair would suddenly die if the time moves on across the point T2, yeah, because then the Numerair pays and it's no longer defined as a financial product. So maybe one nice choice of a Numerair is the bond that pays one unit at the last time of my interest rate curve, because after that point, my interest rate curve is gone and the whole model is no longer existing. So I have a certain time horizon here in this model, and I choose now the zero coupon bond that is associated with the time horizon of this model. It's the Tn bond, the Numerair that pays one unit at Tn. Okay, so maybe that's a nice choice. So from Gersanov's theorem, I know that if I choose this Numerair and I would like to move to the equivalent martingale measure associated with the Numerair, then the stochastic process changes and there is another drift in front of the DT coming from the move to this Numerair. And now I like to determine this drift. Okay, so this measure here is in the literature sometimes called the terminal measure, yeah, because it is associated with the time horizon. Yeah. So Tn is the time horizon of our model. So how did we derive the drift in other situations? So it was that we know the drift of some objects, namely traded assets divided by the Numerair are martingales. Yeah? So this is the definition of the equivalent martingale measure. So the trick is now you search for traded assets divide by the Numerair, where you can rewrite this ratio as a function of the objects that appear in your model. Then you have a function of Li for which the drift is zero, and a function of a stochastic process. You find the stochastic process of a function of a stochastic process by Itô's lemma. So the scheme is now always the same. Write down this ratio of traded assets, write it as a function of your model objects, apply Itô's lemma, and Itô's lemma will then result in a stochastic process where the drift appears, and then this stuff where the drift appears has to be equal to zero, yeah, because you know from the beginning that the drift of this was zero. So, which traded assets do we know? So, our model has a certain time discretization, but we know the zero coupon bonds at our time discretization. So, I know the zero coupon bond PTI. So, dividing the zero coupon bond PTI with the Numerair, the ratio of PTI divided by PTN. So this guy here is the Numerair. No, so we've chosen that guy as the Numerair. I can express this as a telescope product. Yeah? So PTK divided by PTK plus one, K from I to N minus one. And you know, this here is just the ratio of two zero-cobalt bonds. This is just one plus the forward rate from TK to TK plus one multiplied with the period length. Okay, so now for the period length, I write here delta TK. Was that somewhere? No, maybe I write this here. So delta TK is TK plus one minus TK, the period length. So you see, this is a product of one plus delta K LK. So this is an expression, a function of all our forward rates. So we know that the drift of this is zero under our measure Qn, n being Pn. Yeah? So the drift of this guy here is zero. So I know that the drift of this product here is zero. So I finally have that the drift of the product of one plus delta K LK is zero. So now I have a function of the LKs. The function is take the product of one plus delta K LK. So I use now Itô's lemma to derive the stochastic process. So use Itô to derive the stochastic process. Of this product. Okay, alternatively, you could apply the product rule of stochastic processes. Yeah, there's a product rule, but the product rule is also just proven by Itô's lemma. Okay, so what happens if you differentiate a stochastic process? So I differentiate, I apply the D to this product k from I to n minus one, one plus delta K LK. Note that I here is still a free choice. Yeah, so we have this now. What I do, I have it for all I. I have it for all I because I have that this here holds for all TI. Yeah, this is for all TI a martingale. So actually I have n equations here. Yeah, I have n times the property that I know something where the drift is zero. So let's do it for this one I. So if you differentiate a product, what happens if you get the product multiplied with the inner derivative, where inside the product one guy is missing. Yeah, so I get the product k from I to n minus one. K is not equal j. And for j, I get the inner derivative. The inner derivative of one plus delta k lk is just so for the ith element, k for the jth element, k equal to j, is just delta j dlj. So that is just the inner derivative of the product. And then I have a product, so I get this for every factor. Yeah? So in addition, I get a sum over all j's. So differentiating the product is the sum over all factors, the product where this factor is missing, multiply with the derivative of the factor. So now we have stochastic processes. So in Itô's lemma, there's also a second order term. So the second order term is differentiate two factors in the product. So I get the sum over two of those factors, J and L. Then I get the product where I have differentiated, so where I have removed these two factors, the product without the factor J and without the factor L, multiplied with the inner derivative of the two factors, the factor J and the factor L. And that's the product rule. So what I have here is just the product rule for stochastic processes. Okay, you can look it up if you don't believe it. It's quite easy, yeah, or maybe intuitive. So now to make this here a little bit quicker, yeah, I make a small trick. How about adding here in this product the factor J? And also here, adding in this product the factor J and L. Then the product has an additional factor, which I actually have to remove. Yeah? So here I have to divide by the additional factor, which I have donated to the product. And here I have to divide by the additional factor, the two additional factor, which I have donated to the product. Okay, so by that, you see that the product here is always the same. So the product here is always the same. It no longer depends on the J in the summation, and the same here, and can be moved in front of this sum. So I can move the product in front of the sum. Yeah, moves in front of the sum. And I just have the sum now for the first order terms, yeah, differentiate 1 plus delta LK. Yeah. There is the inner derivative divided by the factor which we have differentiated, and I have the same for all second order terms. Yeah. And you see in the second order terms, usually you have this 1/2, yeah, but I can't spare this 1/2 because here I just sum over L greater than J. Okay, so here this is a double sum. This is a sum over J, this is a sum over J, then a sum over all L, where L is greater than J. So I can move this sum over J in front and have it here. And you see that what is left is the first order term plus the sum of the second order terms where L is larger than J. So now I have this stuff in a very nice form here. Yeah. So now that I have this in a very nice form, now we can easily see the drift. So we had that for all I, the drift of this product is zero. So this means I have that for all I, the drift of this guy here is zero. So this here is a factor. Yeah, so actually the drift of this guy here has to be zero. So I have that for all the I, the drift of this summation here, the dt part here is zero. So that means the sum of all those drifts is zero. Okay, so now you see for all I, the sum from j to n minus one has to be zero. So let's start with I equals n minus one. It means the sum from j from n minus one to n minus one has drift zero. So sum from n minus one to n minus one, this is just this object here for j equals n minus one has drift zero. And then the next sum goes from n minus two to n minus one, but you already know that the summation terms, the sum and n minus one has drift zero. So from that, you conclude that this guy here for j equal n minus two has to be zero. So actually you see that not only the sum has drift zero, it's every element of the sum, every summand has drift zero. So all those guys here have drift zero. And now I just plug in the stochastic processes for the DLJDLL. So let's plug in our model, and then the mu dt will appear. So now I use our stochastic processes. So DLJ is mu j dt plus sigma j dw. And what do we have here if we have a product of two? It's dj times d, DLJ times DLL. So that will be that part here. Okay. So this is these two. Okay, so if we plug this in, I get, and we collect the dt parts. Yeah, so the drift is what is in front of dt. I get from here mu times delta divided by 1 plus delta times L. So that's this part here, mu times delta divided by 1 plus delta times L. And here I get delta J delta L divided by 1 plus delta J L J divided by 1 plus delta L L L. And then we get the correlation term, the instantaneous covariance term. DLJ, DLL is sigma J, sigma L, rho JL, dt. We get that here. Okay, so you see there is a common factor which you can cancel out. Yeah, so it's that one here. And now you can just solve the equation and see that the drift is minus this sum of the correlation terms, or instantaneous covariance terms. So we found the drift. And that specifies now our model under the terminal measure, under the measure corresponding to the numerator, cause being the bond that pays at the final time tn. And note that you can immediately see here that mu n minus 1, mu n minus 1, this is here an empty sum. It's all L being larger than J plus one. This is the triangle which we were summing, but L also being smaller than N minus one, the sum is empty. So this means that the mu N minus one is zero. As we know that the last forward rate is a martingale. So the forward rate from Tn minus one to Tn has to be a martingale. And you also see that all the other ones, they have a drift, yeah. So given that this part here is not zero, or the other ones, they will have a drift, and the drift is negative, and this corresponds to what we saw for the convexity adjustment. Yeah, if the numerator is at a later point in time than the rate, then there is a drift adjustment, and it's negative. Okay, so the model is now specified. We know the drift. I will check the drift under a different numerator in the next session. And then we will continue and explore this model.